Thank you. Thank you. You may be seated. On behalf of the family, I want to welcome you to this time of celebration of a dear, dear friend and a dear man to a lot of us. A man who wore many hats and held many positions in his ripe old age of 103, almost 104 years. I want to ask if you would join me as we go to the Lord in prayer. Our Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity, Lord, to come and worship you this morning. Lord, you tell us in your word that this is the day that you have made to let us to rejoice and be glad in it. And Father, we know that in these situations it's so hard to find reasons to be glad. But that's if we look at it through the lens of hopelessness. Father, we know that in the life of a believer, Lord, for those who come by way of the cross, for nothing that we have done, just by following you, the shed blood of Jesus, the one who had victory over sin, death, hell, and the grave, that's where hope lies, and that's where we can have joy this afternoon. We can have joy that although we may not see Mr. Wayne, we know he's very much alive. We know he is with you. We know he can see, and he has been by your side. He's laid down at your feet, and he's had a home going with family and friends. And, Lord, we can be a little bit envious of that. Father, I pray that this service, Lord, that we would be able to honor him. But by doing so, I know he'd want us to honor you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. His faith is now his sight. Amen? Amen? Weeks before I knew this moment would come, months before, Joe and the family told me of Wayne's wishes. At that moment, I felt it'd be real easy because a lifetime of memory should be real easy to share. But being honest, when I sat down at the computer, I had no idea how to start. Where do you start? What do you say? How do you start? And how do you adequately describe a man who lived the life to its fullest, and not just partially? When a lot of people, when you talk about being 103, I ask Joe. Now, Joe's a little bit like Wayne. I said, are we going to give him 104? She said, no. But 103 good years. Years that for the last few was difficult. But how do you adequately share about him? So I'll start from the beginning. One of my favorite things to do with Mr. Wayne was to sit and talk about the old days. He was the link to a world that most of us have never known and will never know. He was born on April the 24th in 1920, and he grew up in a world that seemed so foreign to most of us. His days were spent on the farm, just right down the road, right here. He'd woke up at daylight to work in the fields. And his mother would help, and the only break that she would get would be to go cook long enough for the family to have a meal, and then she'd be right back in the field working again. Their nights, their days would be waking up at daylight, going till nights. Their supper would be cornbread and milk and any summer vegetables they had left over. On the weekends, on Saturday morning, starting at 3:30 in the morning, him and his dad would load up the two-horse wagon, but it wouldn't be a two horses, it'd be two mules. And they'd head off to Anderson Mill, and they'd go there to sell and plunder watermelons. He said, and if we were lucky, we'd make $12 whole dollars. He said, and then on the way back, my dad would give me a quarter, and I'd buy two hot dogs, probably double onions per hot dog, two hot dogs, an RC Cola, and I'd have a dime left over for a movie. In 1939, he had joined the Navy, and he'd find himself in the North Atlantic when Pearl Harbor was bombed. And he put a ship in commission and went to the Pacific, and Jimmy's going to talk a little bit about that. He's got some wonderful stories. But he said, I spent 33 days without seeing any land in World War II. He said, on a floating garage ship called the Mindanao. At the end of the war, when it was over, I was 4,500 miles away in New Guinea, and it took him 3 weeks, two ships, to get home. After he got home in the war, somehow, some way, he talked this woman named Irene to marry him. Now, let me tell you something about Miss Irene. We could go on and on and on about her. He married her on June the 8th in 1946. He said it almost was a spur of the moment type thing. He tried to beg her. He said, I knew what I had, and I tried to trick her. I said, let's just get married today. And she said, I can't. I don't have my hair fixed. And he said, boy, you should have seen that wedding. How many people were there? It was me, Preacher Eustace, and his wife, and Mario Rogers. What a crowd. He said, not long after that, I went to Vandy because I knew I had what it took to be a doctor. And after I got up there, I didn't have the tools necessary to do just that. So I became a teacher. He moved home and started teaching in 1952 at Williamston High School in what became Palmetto. He then was the principal at Cedar Grove, then moved to Wren Elementary, and then back to Williamston Primary. Not long after they built the old middle school that is now torn down, he became the first principal of what is now Palmetto Middle School. Speaking of his time as a principal, I don't know why Miss Irene thought it would be a good idea to teach at the same school he was a principal. Well, he made a fatal mistake one day. One day he was having trouble. Some substitutes needed to be called. Teachers were calling out, and Mr. Wayne started calling for some substitutes. Time was ticking by. He had to get to work because he was the principal. So he left Miss Irene. I think she may even volunteer to help that day, right? We don't really know. Irene, you do this. She did it, and doing so, it made her late. She goes to school. Guess whose name ended up on the tardy board? Irene Rogers. Go to have a conversation with Irene Rogers, and I'm not sure exactly how the conversation went down. I don't know, but I do know there were some things along the lines of, maybe I was late because of you. We're not talking about this anymore, and we're sure not talking about this at home. You can let it go. I firmly believe with all of my heart that if there was only one person, not just a woman, but one person who could live their life with Wayne J. Rogers, it would be Miss Irene. Now, I know that without a doubt that I can tell you right now, and Joe and Marty and Bridget, Tony, they'll all share this with you. One of my favorite things to do was just be on the fly on the wall when they were kind of having their family spats. And then when it was reciprocated, when he would get after me for something and they would all laugh at me. You know, one thing that jumps out at me was when I think about these stories, and one that I would love to really have been on the wall to see the argument go down was back in their old pig farming days. Now Wayne was at the head of the pig, and Irene was at the back end of the pig. And when Wayne said Irene, she would shock the pig, and the pig went through and got Wayne. Well, I think the more Wayne said Irene, the more she hit the pig. Over and over and over again. Now, I told the family earlier, I said, the truth has now come out in glory. The truth is, Irene, did you really mean to shock the pig, or was it just an accident? Let me tell you, Miss Irene was a handful and the perfect one for Mr. Wayne. She was a dear, dear saint. Now, that's the Wayne that I didn't see. But let me back to tell you about the one that I did. Wayne went on a lot of mission trips, and Jimmy's going to share some of those with Griff And what a homecoming he had with his friend now. But I got to go on a mission trip, and I'm going to try to keep this as PC as possible, okay? I'm trying to figure out how to do that. But we went to Connie Maxwell one day. You can see that picture up here. Connie Maxwell trip. Man, this was a wonderful trip to have. Mr. Wayne, if you didn't know this, and it drove really Tony crazy more than anybody, he would have these accidental coughing spells sometimes when he was eating. And it would be so quick, he couldn't get his hand up fast enough, right? Well, he was overcooking Connie Maxwell. Brandon Hawkins was sitting beside me. He had a big old pan of bacon he was about to cook. And bless his heart, he had a coughing spell. And I look over at Brandon Hawkins, he's going, I mean, it was all over the bacon. And Brandon said, "What is he about to do with that bacon?" I said, "Bro, we're about to eat that bacon." And you know, he put it in the oven and it tasted perfect. There was nothing wrong with it. There aren't many memories I have here involving the church that doesn't involve him. You know, in all actuality, y'all, you know that Marty tried to kill me when I was a child. But the reality is the earliest memory that I have of him, honestly, as a child, was when I did run out in front of Marty. Mr. Wayne took me out of my mother's arms and sat me down and talked to me. Every time I come to the grounds of Beaverdam, he was here. He was there. Some of the earliest memories I have, Zeke, wave your hand. Earliest memories I have here is Zeke and I racing. You know, Mr. Wayne, it seemed like only fitting that he would be the Sunday school director because that's what he did in his secular life. Zeke and I would race on Sunday mornings to get up to that second floor Sunday school office. Sweet memories. To race, to be the first to get to touch the bell. Now, I beat Zeke more than he did me. But I wanted, for those of you who have been at Beaverdam, you will attest that the bell under Wayne's leadership kind of progressed over the years, didn't it? We used to get the 1040, ding, it's about time to get done. Y'all remember that? 1040, just a little hit, y'all need to start wrapping it up, and 1045 will be the long one. Well, as he got older, it was 1035, 1040, 1045, 1050. He loved that bell. I remember Wayne taking up the back seat. He sat in the back right corner of the choir. And then he sat down here when he couldn't get up that easily in the choir that often. Some of my memories are one you just saw right here. Him, Joe, and Steve singing oftentimes. Or the times he would stand behind the pulpit and do his best to sound like George Beverly Shea. And rolling them R's, singing, "Oh, hear us when we cry to thee for those in peril on the sea." Those are the memories that are etched in my mind of him. And out of all the memories, though, there's two that stands out more than anything. Two that, you know, Jimmy said this. He got to preach here not too long ago, and it's very rare for a young man to grow up in the church and then get to pastor that church. It's very rare because Francis is looking over the organ thinking, "Why didn't I just let him fall out the window?" It's hard. It's very difficult. Because people that watched you grow up, they sometimes have a hard time looking past that young man. I left and I come back home to serve here, and I was called to be the pastor in March of 2022. I remember because I put this in my phone. On the 23rd, Joe called me, and she said, "Daddy wants to talk to you." He picked up the phone, and I wasn't Brandon. I was a preacher. I'll never forget that. March. "Preacher, can you come? I'd like to talk about the barbecue." I'm thinking, it's 7 months away. But nevertheless, we go and we have that conversation. He wanted to discuss that, and any person that's been around would know that the barbecue was his baby. It got his start after he come back from the war with those men that he served with, not just the ones he served with, but those in his Sunday school class. It was so precious to him, I believe he probably asked his family to have a barbecue instead of a funeral. Right? How would we do that? You know, but the reality is, That was his baby. Wayne in the senior men's class took it over as those men went home to be with the Lord. But after that class started getting over, we had a conversation. And they wanted to turn it over to someone. There, Mr. Wayne, and that class turned it over to me. And I made a promise that day that I'd do everything in my power, and I will do everything in my power to carry out that barbecue exactly how he wants it. That year, I followed him around with a computer. I copied recipes, I listened to stories, and I wrote down some of the ridiculous rules, like still today we debate, do we throw out the bell pepper juice or do we put it in the mix? What do we do? But that's the kind of stuff that we would write down. In 2022, he couldn't get around much, and we had to come out with a new way, a new thing, a new way to do the hash. So myself, Wade, and Morris, and old Brad Foster back there, we got together and we put our heads together. Morris, he made this little template so we can make a double boiler back there. And I took the recipe that Wayne gave me, and we made it, and we made it, and we made it, and we kept working at it. And finally, we got it right. So I take it to his house. and he tries it. 2023, he couldn't come down here at all. 2023, he tasted it. And I often said this about Wayne. If there was closed captioning in your conversations, it would say, pause for dramatic effect. So I give him a bite of the hash, and he says, it needs sugar. We put 75 pounds of sugar in the sauce. Wayne, it was never sweet enough. And then here's the second memory. He tasted it, and he said, preacher, there's a story in the Bible about a man handing over a mantle. Joe was there. My mother was there. And I paused for a moment. I didn't realize. He says, no, I'm sure of it. Elijah did it to Elisha. So go read it. And I did. Mr. Wayne tells you to do something, you read it. In 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 19 and 20, Elijah was running from Jezebel, having a hard time with them. He's depressed, and he's about to hand over the reins, essentially, to the prophetic ministry that he's doing. And here's what it says. So he departed from there and found Elisha, who was plowing with the 12 yoke of oxen before him. And he was with the 12th. Then Elijah passed by him and threw his mantle on him. And he left the oxen and ran after Elijah and said, please, let me kiss my father and mother, and then I will follow you. See, Elisha was plowing in the field, and Elijah threw his mantle, showing him to be the successor. It was at that moment that I realized Wayne was saying, okay, you honored what you told me you would do. It's good. It's yours. Now, he handed that over to me. And then I got to thinking, really, since then, at 103, you have to do that a lot, don't you? You have to hand over a lot of mantles in your life. Mantles that Wayne, being no different and being his friend and being close to him, I saw those. Now, he was reluctant about a lot of them because he was a good man, but he was stubborn. But the best that he could, you need to hear me say this, the best that any man could that spent his life as a leader in every aspect of his life, I think he did pretty well handing over some of these mantles. I saw him have to give the mantle of care over to someone else. Ruby, Melanie, Tess, would you raise your hands? Let me tell you something. You need to stand up right now. All three of you, stand up. Go ahead. What you see right here is not three caregivers, but three family members. And it's very hard to see, but Mr. Wayne, even though he struggled to give his care over to them, they did so, and they did so with grace and love. And it wasn't a job. You need to hear me say this. They loved Mr. Wayne. And that blessed my heart to see that. And so on behalf of the family and myself who love this man dearly, thank you so much. Because not only what you did was you not a blessing to them, you made it available so the family themselves could actually know that he was left in good hands so they could have some time to step away. You know, another mantle that he had to hand over, that was it would be virtually impossible for anyone, but especially hard for him, would be the mantle of vision. Mr. Wayne, when I say his vision would leave him, it wasn't just that it was blurry. He was going blind. He was having huge dark spots, and as a result, he could not see. He would often tell me that how much he longed to read. He loved to read, and he loved to read the Bible, and he did for up till really the last, 3 or 4 years, really. He did the best he could. And as a result of him not being able to see, he had to hand over the mantle to driving, except for one time. 2019, he could not drive. He was not supposed to drive. He was blind, was he not, Tony? Now, they're still sore about this, but I've got the microphone, okay? It was Thanksgiving of 2019, and you hear Joe, I forgot to lay out the turkeys. Joe forgot to lay out the turkeys. I was so nervous to meet Wayne down here on that Thursday to cook them. But we got here and they were laid out. And I said, Joe, did you do it? She said, no. I said, Joe, did you do it? And she says, no. Wayne said, I did it. Joe said, who drove you, Daddy? And he said, I drove myself. Now, I asked him, about 2 weeks later, he said, I prayed all the way there and all the way back. Now listen, I went back the long way to make sure Martin's fence was still standing. I do not know how he made it here and he made it back, but he did it all by himself. And it was after that, the keys disappeared. No longer. I believe that the reason Mr. Wayne was able to do this as good as possible was because of one reason. And this is where I want you to hear me well. He knew that although 103, 104 years is an age that not many of us will see, he still knew that in the grand scheme of eternity, it was nothing. He knew that he was but a vapor on this earth, a pilgrim in a land. And oftentimes that he would ask me, he'd say, Brandon, why do you think the Lord has kept me here so long? I'd first tell him, because God's got a plan for you. And then the second thing is, right now, Irene's winning. I'd say, Lord, give me one more day. Give me one more day. He loved to hear me say that. But he knew one thing. One thing was that although his life was long and it was full, it was still short in the grand scheme of eternity. Hebrews 11 says this in 13 through 16. It says, these all died in faith. These all is the patriarchs, Abraham and all of those. It says, these all died in faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on earth. They're saying that they're on the front side of the first advent of the Messiah. They hadn't known who Jesus was yet, but they had faith that he was coming. They had faith that they knew that they were just sojourners. Their long-term plan had nothing to do with being on earth. They were headed to a land far away that God himself somehow, some way would do. That's what this verse means. And it goes on to say in verse 14, for people who speak such things make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. That's what Wayne would tell us oftentimes. He was just ready to go be with Jesus. And it goes on to say in verse 16, but as it is, they desire a better country, that is a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. See, this is the reason that I believe Wayne could ultimately be okay with handing over these mantles. Because he knew that while this verse is about the heroes of the faith before Christ's coming, he still had not seen the home that Jesus had prepared for him. He was still living by faith that the promise that when he closed his eyes on this side of an eternity, he would wake up in the presence of Jesus, healed and whole. And he knew that. And that was his motivation for everything that he did. A land that he wouldn't just be passing through. A land that would fix everything that sin and death had destroyed. Because there's no more sin there. There's no more crying. There's no more heartache. And all the former things have passed away. And Wayne knew that. And later on in Hebrews, it says in Hebrews 12, but you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God. See, what's so fascinating about Hebrews 12 is the first part of that chapter, they're talking about Mount Sinai. Now, if you'll remember, on Mount Sinai, only one man was allowed to come up to the presence of the Lord. His name was Moses. He was so bright with the glory of the Lord, they didn't want to look at him. Only one person could come up on Mount Sinai. But you know what he says in Hebrews 12? On Mount Zion, all are welcome to the city of God. Why? It wasn't because of what Wayne did. It was because he repented of his sins and put his faith, hope, and trust in Jesus. See, on Mount Zion, everyone is welcome who comes by way of the cross. And we're not just pilgrims passing through that land. Friend, I want to tell you, I can sit here with a heart that's broken and equal joy in knowing that I'm going to dearly miss this man. Hey, I know without a doubt that he loved me. He told me as often as I talked to him. I'm going to miss him. But you know what I'm excited for? I'm excited for him. He can see. He can hear. He's been with Miss Irene. He's been with Griff. And he will never be separated again. And one day, not too long from now, every single one of us that come by way of the cross will get to see him as well. And all God's people said, amen. Amen.
After that young preacher quit, what's an old man going to say? I'm going to try to talk loud enough you can hear me, but I had lung trouble, but 82 years, so I'm glad you can hear me as well as you do. I'm not supposed to comment on the preacher before me, am I? Y'all know where he developed that strong voice? Running away from his training union teacher, trying to chase him down in the graveyard and get him back in church training. Ain't it so?
Amen.
Amen. I hadn't even thought about doing that, Reverend Brandon. and I hadn't thought about doing this first. I thought about mentioning my mom, and then I said I wouldn't, but I am. Her birthday is tomorrow. I can remember his birthday because it's 1 month later. 1 month. And family, I'll never forget. She died 1 month short of 98, so she didn't make it as long as Mr. Wayne. She had a stroke on Saturday. She was put in the hospital. Along about Thursday, the palliative care people wanted to talk to us about getting her out of the hospital so they could have another bed. Well, she didn't make it, but that's all right. That was a shortcut to glory for her. That guy said just how fortunate we were that she was at home. It wasn't stretched out as bad for her as it was for Mr. Wayne. But where I'm going with this is, thank you so much for recognizing these three folks. But I also know that you took a lot of times too. And my friend Doug, whom Wayne loved dearly, lives in North Carolina, made such a comment about how you were taking care of him. And I know it's because you loved him and he loved you. And he loved the children, loved the grandchildren. And I said to one of the in-laws, he even loved most of the in-laws. And he did, didn't he? He did. He loved you. He loved this church. He put his heart over here. He was a leader because he was on the premises. He was involved. We'd have a big, something like the barbecue. Next meeting, we sat down. How could we have done that better? I don't know whether he got that from schoolwork or his time in the military, but what if... I wish more preachers in the Southern Baptist Convention would ask that question. Now let me go back to where I was going to start. The story from the South Pacific. And it's different. I'd forgotten for sure. We had a man in Gastonia, where I was before I came here. And he had served in the North Atlantic during World War II. Come find out, I wasn't remembering clearly that Mr. Wayne had served over there. And then he went to the South Pacific. But one of the most powerful stories he told me was they were, I guess, anchored, and there was a ship anchored. At first, I thought he meant next door, right? You know, just, but several hundred yards. Now, he was an electrician on the ship, and they were finishing up the shift or whatever it was, and a couple of the guys said, we're going to the mess, we're going to eat. He said, go ahead, I got to do some paperwork. Well, y'all, they went ahead. They got there in time for the Japanese to blow that ship up over there with a torpedo. And all kinds of metal came toward Wayne's ship. And those two guys caught that metal and they died. And Wayne lived. And what a life he lived after he survived that. What a life. Didn't you say something about he went up to Vanderbilt to study for to be a doctor? Man, can you imagine him in the operating room? That's free. Well, my friend Doug went to school in Nashville. He and Wayne got to trading stories. And Doug had a fine experience. Met up with some powerful individual up there. He said, if you ever have any problems, you just let me know. And he did, and the man helped him. And he, Wayne Rogers said the same thing. He was singing in the First Baptist Church Nashville, Tennessee choir. He was living life after that tour in the military. Fell in love with that place up there. But you hit the nail on the head. He fell in love with a little girl down here and he came on home. As they say in Dutchman, where I grew up, sure enough. He wound up, yeah, you named them all, principal over at middle school when I was here. And he told me two or three stories about the middle school. And I think I can tell some of them. He told Jane and me that this kid had misbehaved and he had to whip him. So back in those days, you know, you get the secretary to come in and be the witness. So if this goes to trial, the secretary can provide the information. Well, she's over here and Mr. Wayne's getting ready for the paddle to warm a boy's britches. And that boy looked over there and said, "Help me, ma'am." I think he had a good thought. He told me one lady came in, and she wasn't mad. She wasn't angry. She was fighting furious mad. And she let him have it with both barrels about something about disciplining her child. And she said, "My husband will be here after school, and you better be ready because he's going to take care of you." Well, Mr. Wayne interpreted that to mean he was going to have bodily harm about in the afternoon. Y'all remember George Seaburn, Mr. Seaburn? Yeah, superintendent. Wayne calls him up, told him about the threat the lady made. Said, "Mr. Seaburn, I'm a country boy and I got an axe handle behind my desk. And if he starts across the desk or around the desk, I'm going to use the axe handle." "Well, fine, Wayne. Let me know how it goes." Well, the husband came in, and he wasn't near as mad as the woman. He was meek and mild and polite, and Mr. Wayne didn't have to use the axe handle. Oh, my. So, let's see. Where am I? Yeah, missionary. He was a missionary. He and, by the way, the reason he lived almost 104, he was trying to live as long as Griff. Now, for those of you who don't know, Griff lived way down in about Fort Worth, Texas, and Dallas. He volunteered way up to 100. He drove to the Baylor Hospital as a volunteer, and He was there so much, and they realized he was so old. Well, he lived 106, seven. They said, when you die, we want you to donate your body. He said, "What?" He said, "We want to examine it and see how you live so long." Mr. Wayne was trying to pass him, I think. Oh, my soul. He was a leader in this church. He was here. He was present. He was a worker. And I just thank God for him. Now, once in a while, somebody gets jealous of a man like that, but that's all right. He's so busy doing, he's not worried about who's jealous, right? Mission trips. One time the convention, South Carolina Baptist Convention, asked him to organize a group and take us to Romania, and he did, and we did, and helped me out. Me, Donna, and Jimmy, and Amy, and Muriel, and Sandra. Is that everybody? Now, two of them stayed in the Capitol and did prayer walking, but the rest of us went out in the country, and we witnessed in Romania. Well, I went up to Friendship Church, which is just up the road from me, this morning, and gave a little talk so I could get my breakfast free. But really, I said, "Preacher, how long you want me to talk?" He said, 10 minutes. Preacher talked 10 minutes? Well, I did. But what I started to tell you, there were two guys there from Romania, Mr. Wayne. They were from Romania. And he led us there and got us back. And it was a great trip. Seems to me like years ago, y'all had a 50th anniversary celebration over here in the Lowry Building. I thought I remembered that right. You talking about Miss Irene? They told over there she wanted a new carpet years ago. Now, you remember Mr. Wayne, I didn't say this, one of the reasons I think he went to the Army, the Navy, before the war started, was so he could mail a check back home because Daddy was dead and Mama needed to eat. That's part of what I understood. So I guess he was still in that mindset, and as much as he loved Miss Irene, he wouldn't buy the carpet. Well, bless your soul, she had ingenuity. Is that a word? She got some spray paint and sprayed the carpet. Now that was a good idea, except it never did dry. And she got a new carpet. Now, this other story I'm going to tell you from that, I understand he would clip his toenails. And he would just leave them where they dropped. And it might have been on that new carpet. Anyway, she swept them up one day, put them in an envelope, put his name and address and his office address on it, and mailed it to him. Now, it's my understanding after that, he got his toenails up. Strong leader, wore many hats. Oh, I don't think I'm supposed to tell this. Somebody, you know, he called me to welcome me to Beaverdam. We got here and we got a pictorial directory. And somebody looked at that man's picture, Wayne Rogers. He's the one you'll have trouble with. Well, he wasn't. We became good friends. Might have some trouble somewhere else. Oh, my soul. He did have a stern look sometimes. Well, if you're a principal, what I mean, or a high-ranking officer, which he was on occasion, that stern look helps. I want to say a couple more things. By the way, Brian, when you're a preacher, you're a younger preacher than I am, you treat every church member just alike, right? Except that's impossible. Because you get a church member like Wayne Rogers and he becomes your friend and it's not the same as everybody else. Do you understand what I'm saying? As much as you try. He came over to the old house. For those of you who don't know, we have a house that was built in 1850. And when we started trying to fix it so we could stay there, it took a lot of work. And he hung chandeliers, he hung lamps, he ran a wire to the water heater. He did, and the Baptist men, the Brotherhood, the Beaverdam Baptist Brotherhood went over there and worked and did the floor and took a chimney down and built a back porch, and we'll forever be grateful. If I can live 30 more years, I'll be grateful till the day I die. Now, you didn't mention one thing I get to say myself, right?
Sure.
Miss Irene
was awarded the Order of the Silver Crescent, right here in this place, mostly for 66 years of teaching school. Boy, somebody teach that long, they need some kind of reward. And Mr. Wayne came back. I came over and preached. And he was so stubborn, he had to walk all the way up those steps and get up here. And he was given the Order of the Palmetto. Now, they didn't do all this to get these awards, but they were certainly people who deserved them. Couple of verses, and I'll be done. Philippians 1:3. I thank my God for every remembrance of you. And I will thank my God for every remembrance of him till they take me out to the cemetery. I will. And I want to read 4 verses from the 2nd chapter of Philippians. Verse 8 has to do with his Savior. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself, Jesus did, and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him a name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And I think that verse, those verses, reflect some of why he lived the Christian life that he lived.
Today we gather in grief and gratitude, with hearts heavy with the loss of Wayne Jefferson Rogers, yet we're uplifted by the memory of a life well lived. His century-long journey finds a parallel in the wisdom of Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. Let me read this to you. It says, "There is an occasion for everything, and a time for every activity under heaven, a time to give birth, and a time to die, a time to plant, and a time to uproot, a time to kill, and a time to heal, a time to tear down, and a time to build, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to throw stones, and a time to gather stones, a time to embrace, and a time to avoid embracing, a time to search and a time to count as lost, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love, a time to hate, a time for war
at a time for peace. Wayne Rogers embraced every one of these seasons, understanding that within each season, it lauded its own unique beauty and purpose. First, there's that time to give birth. Now, Wayne didn't give birth, right? But Wayne Rogers entered this world over a century ago, which is a time that is far removed from the world that we occupy. I never will forget probably my first men's brotherhood breakfast early on a Tuesday morning. We met, and I'm sitting across from Wayne Rogers, and I had set my cell phone out on the table, and I began getting email notifications, bing, 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 bing. And Wayne said, "What's that?" And I said, "Now, I'm about 25-ish at the time." And I said, well, Mr. Wayne, that's email. And I said, you know, if you're trying to explain it, it's like a physical letter, like mail, but it's coming to me digitally and electronically on my phone. He said, "Put that away." And I said, okay. Is that a problem? He says, "When I was your age, my mail came to me on a horse and buggy on a dirt road called Midway." I put my phone away. But that's the kind of man, that's the kind of era in which Wayne grew up in. And then I'm sure it's a long reason as to why I'm running in this late. Our tire, our left tire just blew up on the interstate at exit 4. And so Wayne kept us enough to get off the road. And then Brittany Couch came and got us, and she has a future with Uber. I just need you to know that. When my stomach finally settles, I'm going to be okay. But I don't know what all stories has been mentioned today. But Wayne, of course, his military service embodied a time of war and a time of peace. Like countless brave souls, Wayne experienced World War II firsthand, standing resolute in the face of turmoil. Later, his service in the reserves demonstrated a continued dedication to safeguarding times of peace. And as mentioned, some 66 years as an educator, that, I believe, embodies his time to plant. Like a gardener nurturing tender seedlings, Wayne embraced this call. And he wasn't merely a teacher, but he was a God that channeled God's fatherly and disciplinary love for countless students. I don't know if this story was shared. I think I heard one about the axe handle, right? The story that was told to me about him paddling somebody, as I remember, someone shared it with me. I don't know if Wayne told it to me or somebody else. I don't think I dreamed this up. Was two young boys had gotten into trouble and were taken to the office. And they knew that meant they were going to be paddled by Wayne. And apparently, from everything I understand, thank God Wayne never spanked me, but Wayne would have the students put their hands on his desk, and he would paddle them. Well, Wayne's a large man. I mean, I wouldn't want to take a paddling from Wayne. And so Wayne paddled the first one, and the boy's wristwatch flew off his hand. And they told me the second boy came up, and before he started, he took his wristwatch off and laid it on the desk. And Wayne was planting seeds of potential that would blossom into lives of purpose. And then there's Wayne and his retirement, which for Wayne, it wasn't a time of rest. It was a time to build. Alongside Griff, as mentioned earlier, he embarked on a remarkable journey, bringing the light of the gospel to distant corners of the globe. And with each wire placed, with each brick laid down, it became a testament to his devotion to the spread of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then I think about a time to love. When it comes to a time of love, he embodied that mostly with his family. He loved his wife and his kids and his grandchildren. He cherished every connection. And I know I don't have to restate it today, but I am. He loved all of you, maybe even Marty. Y'all laugh so hard because y'all know it's true. I mean, it's just true. But yes, family, especially the kids, you took such good care of him in his final season of life. And that's to honor you. That's to honor you. It's in these moments of grief, too. I never had the privilege to meet Irene, but I just think the image of Wayne reunited in heaven with his beloved Irene has to offer you profound comfort today, right? Profound comfort. Family gatherings, especially around dinner table, because that's where you can tell I spent the most time with Wayne. They were filled with laughter and joy. He's probably going to be really upset that I'm about to tell you the joke I'm about to say. But what's he going to do about it, right? I mean, I'm just being honest. This is why you're friends with Wayne. I told Brittany, I said, this is the great thing about arriving in late for Wayne's funeral. I don't think he would have it any other way, right, for my family. But one of my favorite little quips he ever did, I mean, to this day, it still tickles me. I think Reverend Chris Huff and I went to go pick him up one day after a doctor's visit. And he got in the car, and you could see him brimming. He was ready with the joke. And he said, doctor asked how my flow was today. And he said, well, doctor, I'm not washing down any Greyhound buses. I still think about that stupid joke. Isn't it weird what ones you remember? Unreal, man. Wayne's compassionate. Just what? Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Wayne's compassionate heart extended far beyond his family. I mean, we're testament to that today. Wayne wasn't just present. He overflowed with love, and he made each person feel truly treasured. My own mom, I mean, she messaged me this week to remind me of a beautiful moment that illustrates what I'm talking about. Early in my time as a pastor here, my mom, of course, was worried. This is my first, you know, career move away from home. And on one of her first visits, Wayne Rogers approached her and expressed how much he believed in me. And I know that allayed a lot of fears, especially as we talk about when a stalwart like Wayne at a historic church like this says, he's going to do fine. Don't worry about him. That meant a lot. In case you're wondering why I'm dressed so casual today, my wife was upset that I didn't wear a tie. Wayne bought me this jacket and this shirt when I first got here. Now, let me tell you, I can't fit into the pants anymore. I can't. But I thought, in honor of Wayne, I'll do the best I can to put this back on. But as a young pastor, I didn't have any suits and things like that. And I think Wayne had Joe call us up, and he went and took me out and picked out two or three suits, and this is the only part that's made it after all the changes these years. Then I think about just the church outreaches that I was a part of and missions, and I think it exemplifies a time to heal. I mean, you got to remember, when I was here, we had the opportunity to go around to these area neighborhoods and knock on their doors and invite them to church. Wayne would go do that as a 90-year-old man with us. That's pretty remarkable, right? Wayne's faith wasn't some passive mental assent about Jesus. It was a driving force that guided his actions. And whether he was wielding a tool belt or an apron, Wayne embodied the idea that all work, when it's done with a willing heart, offered in service to Christ, that work held eternal value. At church, I mean, I would love to know how many mamas have pictures of him scooping up little ones with those huge hands on probably their first time out of the womb there at church, he'd do it. But it was a simple gesture mirroring Christ's strong yet gentle embrace of the innocent. And then none of us, I'm sure it's already been mentioned by these fellow pastors, but when Wayne would get up to pray, I mean, it's the only time I felt like a man might command God. Yo, listen what I'm about to say. But it was born out of a sincerity of a heart that had a relationship with God the Father. And Wayne's impact, I mean, if you've ever been to his home, we know that it extends far and wide. It's illustrated on a world map in his home that's dotted with pins that represents all the places that life has led him. The outpouring for Wayne, the tributes that echo throughout the years, they paint a vivid picture of the legacy that this man leaves behind. Probably my most cherished conversation, and I literally repeated it maybe a week or two ago, and that was not even in the context of Wayne and his passing, but somebody was just talking about life. And it's rare, I don't know about y'all, I don't have too many 103-year-olds to talk about. So it comes up when people talk about longevity. Hey, I knew a guy who's 103. And as soon as you give the length, right, the next question that most people get is, what does it take to live that long? You get that a ton. And I remember one Sunday early in my tenure here, we would usually go over to the Evans's to eat, and something happened to where the Evans's were out of town. My wife, I think she was maybe my fiance, I don't know, but she wasn't in town, and so it was just me and Wayne. And we went down to the Arby's here at the exit. And we're sitting there, again, he's in his 90s, I'm in early 20s, and we just started chit-chatting. We were talking about finances and handling money right, and I finally just kind of asked a question, Wayne, what would you say to a guy like me about wanting to live a long life? How do you do it? And it was surprising to me how fast he retorted. He replied to me pretty quickly, and the advice that he gave me, what I'm about to tell you, is simple but brilliant, and it's something, well, it's probably the reason I know I won't live to be 103. But he said this, he says, Josh, believe the best in people. And that was it. He says, and here's what I mean by that. He's like, there's a lot of stress that happens in life because you're too worried about what people think, what they're gonna do, you almost become paranoid. And if y'all know Wayne, he didn't care what anybody thought. But he also, he didn't live with the stress of it either. He says, so I just decided a long time ago, I'm going to try to believe the best in people. And that's what he shared with me. I think today, if I had to say this, wrapping it up and knowing Wayne in his life, I think here's what's so amazing, is that Wayne's legacy will not be defined by the length of his life, but by the depth of the impact he made on us. That's the most amazing thing. Wow. That we would forget 103 years and we'll remember those deeply profound moments that we shared with them. His story unfolds not just in grand achievements like his acts of service for our nation or his own presence here at Beaverdam, but also in the quiet moments with each and every one of you. It's the tender care of his beloved Irene. It's the shared laughter with family and friends around the dinner table and the mission trips. It's the countless lives he personally touched. Those will be the precious memories that we truly cherish. They reveal the heart of a man, the essence of a life well lived, and the essence of a life when it's deeply rooted in the Lord Jesus Christ. I think it's fitting to think and wrap up Wayne's life this way from Ecclesiastes 7:1. It says, a good name is better than fine perfume, and the day of one's death is better than the day of one's birth. Wow. And I can say that about Wayne. Think about what all, a life completed giving glory to God. It is a better day. It is. Ecclesiastes also paints out a poignant portrait of a life that's lived out here on the earth underneath the sun. You and I, we experience a relentless cycle of seasons, a chasing after fleeting pleasures. We toil, we strive, we yearn, only to find at the end of life all of our achievements will gather dust. And so a profound emptiness settles in on our hearts, and it echoes the emptiness of King Solomon himself. Remember what Solomon said when he looked back and he had to sum up life. He said, vanity, vanity, all is vanity. It's empty, it's futile, it's absolutely useless. And yet, here's what we find in the rest of scriptures. In the midst of life's impermanence, hope can pierce the darkness because God became a man and entered our time-bound reality. You see, Jesus is not just another pursuit under the sun. He's not just another rung on the ladder of achievement. He is the answer to life's questions, and he is the fulfillment of our deepest longings. In Christ, seasons lose their hold. There is no time to plant and time to uproot because Christ is the eternal vine that sustains each and every one of us. Jesus transcends the cycles of war and peace because he himself is the Prince of Peace. He offers rest for our weary souls, a rest that's not found in earthly pursuits, but in the embrace of God's love. The tears that was spoken about in Ecclesiastes 3, those tears of frustration, the tears of loss, the tears of unfulfilled desires, understand there's coming a day where Jesus himself will wipe away every tear from our eye. Jesus never promised an absence of hardship, a life free from pain, but he did promise his presence to see you through it all. In him, even the time to mourn becomes a transformative experience that draws us closer to the God, Jesus, who wept. As we face the inevitable time to die, we cling not to fading earthly works, but to the eternal promise of Christ. Remember what he said, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me, even if he dies, will live. And Jesus said later, because I live, you will live also. Death today, we can taunt death today. We can laugh today because death lost its sting in Christ. And death becomes the doorway to everlasting life for those who know him. Seasons change, and with them comes profound sorrow and loss. Everything under the sun is ultimately passing away. And as a messenger of the gospel, I have to remind you, you're passing away. Every single one of you are passing away. The book of Ecclesiastes always tells us it's better to go to the house of mourning than to go to a house of feasting. And here's why. Since this is the end of all mankind, the living should take it to heart. I think the reason God permits funerals is because you and me have to come face to face with reality that life's not permanent. We will have to give an account to our Creator, and nothing I think would please Wayne Rogers more is to know that you had an opportunity at his house of mourning today to turn from your sins and give your life to Christ. He would want that most. Christ is the one who gives each of us meaning in our seasons. Ecclesiastes 3:11 said, he, that's talking about God, has made everything beautiful in its time. Romans 11:36, it says, for from him and through him and to him, that's Christ, are all things. Christ is the solace that will transcend every tear. And Christ is the life that will transcend even Wayne's time. It's all about Christ. So may we turn our hearts fully to accept Jesus, the only one who is the source of true and lasting joy. And while we honor him, I know if Wayne was here, he would say this about Christ, to him be the glory both now and to the day of eternity. Amen. I'm going to ask every head bowed and every eye closed. I want to give you the opportunity just to respond to the simple gospel that Wayne Rogers believed in. Wayne, while we honor him today, Wayne was not a perfect man. He was a sinner who had his own faults, and his only solace, his only respite, is that he turned from his sins and trusted Christ as his Savior long ago. And the reason that I have such confidence that I will see Wayne Rogers again in heaven is not because of his military service, his years in the field of education, or his presence here at Mount Carmel. I believe because Wayne believed in the man, the God-man Jesus, who died for him on Calvary some 2,000 years ago. That's what I believe. And I want to invite you to believe in him too. With every head bowed and every eye closed, with no one looking around, Jesus is not dead. He's alive. He's the Son of God. And so he can hear our thoughts and whispers. If you're ready to turn your life away from sin and give your life to Christ like Wayne, would you say this prayer silently in your heart to him? Just say, dear Jesus, I am a sinner who deserves death, but I hear that you have everlasting life. Thank you for coming to this earth, living a perfect life, and dying on the cross for my sin. And I believe God raised you from the dead. Please forgive me. Come into my life. I give my life to you. with every head bowed and every eye closed. I'm not here to embarrass anybody. I'm not going to call you out by name. I just have a simple word of encouragement to you. If you're sitting here and you prayed that prayer just a moment ago, again, no one's looking. It's just a simple testimony between me and you. If you prayed that prayer just a moment ago, would you simply lift your hand high enough to where maybe I could see it? Anybody at all? I see your hand. Anybody else? I want to encourage you. You can lower your hand. If you prayed that prayer today, will you please tell one of Wayne's kids for me? Just tell them, today I gave my life to Christ. There'll be no greater reward for Wayne or any of the kids here than to know that you trust Jesus as your Savior. Let's finish with this prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we bow before you with heavy hearts, yet also with a profound sense of gratitude. Thank you for the gift of Wayne Rogers, a life that reflected your grace and love. We thank you for the seasons he walked through, the ways he served you and those around him, and the deep faith that guided his every step. As we recall his life, may the wisdom of Ecclesiastes resonate with us, remind us of the fleeting nature of earthly things, and ignite within our hearts a deeper longing for the eternal. Help us honor Wayne's memory by living lives that echo his unwavering faith, his kindness, and his devotion to you. Comfort those who mourn, Lord. Be the balm for their aching hearts. May they find solace in the promise of eternity, in the knowledge that Wayne now rests in your heavenly embrace. May his love live on through them. We praise you, Christ Jesus, our Savior and our hope. You alone conquered death. Through you, Wayne's legacy extends beyond this earth. And may we all one day be reunited with him in your glorious kingdom. We pray this in Jesus' strong name, and all God's people say.
Amen. Would everyone but the family please stand?